Welcome back to another video. After my last video, I wanted to work on multiplayer, but once again I got sidetracked by terrain generation. There was this one bug that was bothering me for a while now. As you can see, the tree is growing in the air. That can't be healthy. Intuitively, this bug seems easy to fix. Before generating a tree, just simply check if there's a valid block below. Sadly, it's not that simple. Let's assume we want to generate a single chunk. We start by filling in the base terrain and carving out the caves. We can start placing some trees, and so far it seems to be working. But what happens when a tree starts outside the given chunk? In that case, we might still want to generate some leaves in this chunk. But we don't even know if the tree exists because we didn't generate caves there yet. I don't remember seeing this problem in Minecraft, so how does Minecraft solve it? Minecraft seems to be dividing chunk generation into two phases. One phase for determining the rough terrain shape, and one phase for placing the trees and vegetation. The second phase can only start when all the surrounding chunks finish the first phase. This is a relatively lazy approach and doesn't work in Cubyz for various reasons. Most importantly, at default render distance, it would require to generate twice as many chunks in the first phase, which costs twice as much memory and takes twice as much time. But the underlying idea is good, just the execution is inefficient. To make it better, we need a new data structure. Let's call it a cavemap. For cavemaps, we don't need to know what blocks the walls are made of, we just need to know if it's solid or not. So a single bit per block is totally enough. This greatly reduces memory consumption and has the additional advantage that with some bit magic, multiple blocks can be set at once. Overall, this even gave a performance gain. Additionally, this opens up a lot of possibilities for the rest of terrain generation as well. I could add crazy terrain features and the grass and trees placement just works. There's just one problem though. Right now there's only a 2D biome distribution. So the caves have exactly the same plants as the surface. Making a three-dimensional biome distribution isn't so easy. In 2D, performance doesn't really matter because I'm always looking at a slice of the world. But with 3D biomes, I have to find the biome for every single block, which requires around 100 times more calculations. So instead of doing fancy Voronoi distributions, I have to go back to much simpler shapes. Using cubes seems like a good idea. It's fairly easy to determine in which cube a given point falls. But it has an issue. At every corner there will be up to 8 different biomes meeting. That is wild. Luckily, from solid state physics, I knew that there are other shapes that can be represented by a grid. There is the rhombic dodecahedron, which can be represented by a grid where every second point is missing. And there is the truncated octahedron, which can be represented using two grids that are offset from each other. The truncated octahedron is best suited for my problem because there is only 4 different biomes meeting at the corners. Now I just need to add some noise at the edges and everything is all right. I used some 3D fractal noise for that, but I had to massively downsample to achieve reasonable performance. But I'm happy with the result, and if you don't know all the tricks I used, you won't see a thing. And for the surface, I'm still using the old algorithm anyways. Now that I have some 3D noise implemented, I might as well add some noise caves and see what all the hype is about. Again, for performance, I had to heavily downsample and interpolate. But I must say, the result is pretty good, and with all my optimizations, the overall performance impact isn't that big. With all that done, I could finally add some actual cave biomes. I added a basic cave type with some gravel on the ground and some boulders lying around. You'll encounter this one most of the time. Then I made the crystal caverns actual cave biomes and put them inside the new noise caves. I also added a couple of rarer cave types. There is the crystal forest. Basically, the idea is that the crystals provide enough light for plants to grow, and in some of the crystal caverns there was the right type of soil or whatever for trees and grass to grow. And then there is the stone forest, which features trees made from stone. To hint that this is an artificial structure, I placed some crafting tables in the area. I could add even more biomes, but for now I don't really have many structures and blocks to use, so I'll definitely come back and add more cave biomes and structures later. That all may have sounded simpler than it actually was. Just fixing that one bug took me like a month, and another month for 3D biomes. I can only show so much progress because, well, I rarely make videos. And here we are already in the part of the video where I briefly mention a bunch of other random but noteworthy things. I finally added LOD saving, so if you build something it will be visible in the distance as well. I'm using an interesting sampling technique that tries to mimic the low resolution pattern. As you can see, if I make a checkerboard pattern and fly away, it stays a checkerboard pattern. Even before I started working on the floating tree bug, I already did some new cave generation. I started with a simple algorithm where I take a straight cave, divide it into smaller segments and so on. But working together with Half a Snack, who also made some of the textures, I improved it to a complicated system of branching and recombining caves. Wait, wasn't it called Caves and Cliffs Update? Yes, I also upgraded my mountains. I was playing around and found a cool noise function that generates nice and rough terrain. By working on that, I also made a better transition between the mountains and the other terrain. In older versions, there often was just a flat wall going up. And of course, I made a lot of bug fixes and performance improvements. Most notably, a weird graphics issue that was caused by a double free of OpenGL buffers. Finally, I want to thank all of you who contributed some code, or found some bugs, or gave me ideas and inspiration, or just wrote a nice comment. I really appreciate that. Goodbye.